So in this module, we're going to talk about a few, miscellaneous but important things about equilibrium. What's called the reaction quotient, Q, extent of reaction, heterogeneous equilibria, and how to add equilibrium equations. So first, the reaction quotient, Q. So again, for our generic equilibrium reaction, AA plus BB goes to CC plus DD, Q looks the same as K does. In other words, the concentrations of the products raised to the powers of their coefficients over the reactants raised to their powers, or the partial pressures, the same thing. The difference between Q and K is that for K, these have to be the equilibria concentrations or the equilibrium partial pressures. Q, not necessarily so. You can have whatever the partial pressures or the concentrations are. Now, what does that tell us? Well, it tells us something about which way the equilibrium is going to shift in order to achieve equilibrium. If when you plug in the values for Q, you get the number, if it's less than K, what that tells you is that the equilibrium is going to shift to the right. The system's going to shift to the right to achieve equilibrium. Why is that? Well, if we go back and look at this, if Q is too small, that means the denominator is too big and the numerator is too small. Well, the numerator are the products and the denominator are the reactants. So in order to get bigger to be the same as K, the numerator has to get bigger, which means we need more products, and the denominator has to get smaller, which means we need less reactants. So it's going to shift to the right. On the other hand, if Q is equal to K, well, that's just equilibrium. System's at equilibrium, it's not going to shift either way. But if Q is bigger than K, then just the opposite is up here. The system will shift to the left in order to achieve equilibrium, because if Q is bigger than K, then the denominator is too big, so there's too many products, and it's going to shift back to the left to make more reactants, fewer products. All right, so for example, for this equilibrium here, and we know that K is equal to 13. Let's say you have this system set up where these concentrations are present. We want to know which way the system is going to go in order to achieve equilibrium. Is it at equilibrium? If so, Q will be equal to K. Is it going to shift to the right, make more sulfur trioxide, or is it going to shift to the left, make more sulfur dioxide and oxygen? Well, let's see. So if we plug in, okay, there's the expression for Q. We write it just like K. Again, the only difference is that these are not necessarily at equilibrium. Plug in our values for concentration of sulfur trioxide, sulfur dioxide, and oxygen. And when you plug those numbers in, check my work, but I believe it's 1.3 or so. K was 13, so this is 10 times smaller than K, which means our equilibrium will shift to the right. Okay, extent of reaction, another topic. This is talking about K, so we're finished with Q for the moment, reaction quotient. Now, we're at equilibrium, and we have a value for K, the equilibrium constant. What we can say is that if K is small, that means that at equilibrium, the numerator is small and the denominator is big, which means that there are a lot of reactants and very few products around. And what that means is that that reaction really doesn't go very far to the right, and basically it stays unreacted. There's always some small equilibrium, but you know, a lot of times it's negligible, and that's the case if K is small. If K is big, it's large, then just the opposite is true. Big equilibrium constant means the numerator is large, the denominator is small, so there are a lot of products and very few reactants. What that means is the equilibrium lies far to the right, and basically we say the equilibrium, or the reaction, goes to completion. However, if K is moderate, so how do you define moderate? Well, you know, let's just say as a rule of thumb between 0.001 and 1,000, somewhere 1 times 10 to minus 3 to 1 times 10 to the positive 3. In that case, we're going to say, okay, K is moderate enough to where at equilibrium, there's going to be an appreciable amount of products and reactants around. Heterogeneous equilibrium. If there's a reactant or a product in an equilibrium reaction that's in either the solid or the liquid phase, it's a pure solid or a pure liquid, then it does not appear in the equilibrium constant expression. Why? Well, if you think about it, even if we take, so here's a reaction where there's a solid and a liquid, zinc oxide solid, reacting with carbon monoxide gas to make liquid zinc and carbon dioxide gas. Well, even if we take some of the zinc oxide away, its concentration doesn't change. You know, how many moles per liter? So we take one of these away, we have fewer moles, but we have a smaller volume too. So because it's not changing, it does not affect the equilibrium constant, it does not appear. So the thing to remember is that when you're writing down equilibrium constants, reaction quotients, the same, either in terms of partial pressures or, well, partial pressures is only going to be gases, but concentrations, it's only if it's not a solid or a liquid. So if it's a gas, you write it down, the concentration. If it's a solution, if it's aqueous, you're going to write its concentration down. But if it's a pure solid or a pure liquid, no. All right, so adding equilibrium. When you add equilibrium equations, what you do with their, and you get a resulting equation to get the resulting equilibrium constant, you just multiply the equilibrium constants of the equations you're adding. So, for example, let's say we know the equilibrium constants for these two reactions, right there. And we want to find the equilibrium constant for this reaction. Well, we're going to have to manipulate these equations, okay? Let's say we can't do this experiment. We're going to manipulate these equations so that when we add them up, they equal this equation. And once we do that, once we've manipulated them, then we multiply the resulting case. And remember, we've already learned that if you reverse an equilibrium reaction, you invert the K. So the inverse of the K. So if we reverse this reaction, we're going to take 1 over that to get the K for the reversed reaction. And if we multiply an equation through by some number, we raise the K for that to the power of whatever we multiply it by. So let's see, how can we get this? Well, calcium carbonate's here and it's here, so I think we're going to leave this one alone. But here, we want, we want one carbon solid on the left. Here, carbon solids on the right with a 1/2. We want two carbon monoxides on the right. Here, there's one on the left. So I think we're going to flip this and multiply by 2. So let's do that. So if we flip this and multiply it by 2, we get this. You guys see that? Multiplied everything by 2 and flipped it around. So now, let's get rid of that middle one there. And so, by the way, when we flipped this, we inverted the K for the original reaction. We multiplied by 2, so we raised this K to the second power. And we have this. So now, when we add these equations, this carbon dioxide and this carbon dioxide cancel. There is no carbon dioxide down here. That's good. We have one calcium carbonate on the left, one carbon solid on the left there, one calcium oxide on the right, two carbon monoxides. All right, so these two equations add up to this. All we have to do now is multiply these two Ks after we manipulated this one here, and we get the K for this reaction, K1 times K2 prime. Prime means we inverted it and raised it to the second power. And we get 0.073.